Let's say a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you, God, for our opportunity to come here this morning, Lord, and to celebrate women, to celebrate mothers. We acknowledge, Lord, that so much of what they do reflects your heart and who you are, God. Lord, I just ask, Father, that as we now get into your word, would this be an opportunity, God, for the women and for the men of this church to rest in you, God. Lord, you say in your word, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly of heart. You will find rest for your souls. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Dear Lord, help us to take up the invitation this morning. Lord, would you use my preaching, my words, this passage, God, to penetrate all of our hearts to the end that we would do just that. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, good morning, everyone. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Brian, and I serve here as the associate campus pastor. You're going to need a Bible, because that's what we do here at Harvest Bible Chapel. We read the Bible. So if you could grab a Bible either in front of you or on your phone, we're going to have some words up on the screen behind as well. We're going to turn to Luke chapter 10, verses 38 through 42. Happy Mother's Day, everyone. I wanted to read you guys some funny cards that I saw, Mother's Day cards, and a poem for wives. All right, here's the first card. It's not easy being a mother. If it were easy, fathers would do it. So true. Mom, I love you loads. Speaking of loads, can you do my laundry? Listen to this one. If evolution is true, how come mothers only have two hands? A lot of logic to that. All right, here's a poem for wives. He didn't like my casserole. He didn't like my cake. He said my biscuits were too hard, not like his mother used to make. I didn't make the coffee right. He didn't like my stew. I didn't fold his pants the way his mother used to. I pondered for an answer. I was looking for a clue. He asked me, why can't you do like my mother used to do? And I turned around, looked him straight in the eyes, and smacked him as hard as I could upside his head, just like his mother used to do. Well, we're so thankful for mothers, and you guys are the salt of the earth. You guys are the leaders of the home. We're grateful for all of you. Have you ever asked the question, why do we have 24 hours in a day? Why not 28 hours in a day? Why not 30 hours a day? I mean, gosh, can you think of all the things that you could get done with those extra 4 hours in a day? Or why 365 days a year, Lord? Why not 400 days a year? I mean, think of all that you could get done in your year if you had 400 days in a year. And why do we have to rest? Why sleep, God? You guys acknowledge the fact that sleep is not a result of the fall. It's something that was given. It was a part of God's creation. God ordained that Adam and Eve were to sleep, to rest. It's part of creation. It's a part of who we are. And you and I spend a third of our lives, think about that, laying in a bed doing absolutely nothing. There's nothing productive that happens there. I mean, there is, because we need the rest. But God could have created us without that. Why didn't you just make us to where we could just go and go and go and no sleep, no rest? Think of all that you could get done. Why, God, did you ordain rest? Well, there's a really simple answer, and it's very deep. It's very theological. You ready? You are not God. You are not God. You cannot do everything. And God makes you have to rest. And every day you rest and lay down and do absolutely nothing is a reminder of the fact you are not God. and you are absolutely dependent upon him in your life. In this passage, we're going to look at two women, Martha and Mary. Both women love Jesus. Both women are loved by Jesus. One woman works for Jesus. The other woman worships Jesus at his feet. The title of my message this morning is An Invitation to Rest. Let's read the passage. Now as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. But Martha was distracted with much serving. And she went up to him and said, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me. But the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things. But one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her. This passage comes out of the Gospel of Luke. It's really important for us to remember that the Gospels are not all the same storyline, okay? Each Gospel was written by a different author, and each author has a specific intention. And as you read the Gospels, it's important to recognize that everything that's happening isn't necessarily happening chronologically, okay? We believe that the author, inspired by the Holy Spirit, arranged things in the text exactly as he wanted them to be arranged. And each author has an intention with what he's writing. Luke is significant in this, in that he is writing primarily to marginalized people in the gospel. Okay? Think about that. He's writing to a Gentile named Theophilus. He's writing about Samaritans. He elevates the Samaritan above the Levite and above the Pharisee. And he writes a lot, and I mean a lot, to women. I don't know if you've never noticed this before, but the Gospel of Luke has more encounters with Jesus and women than any of the other Gospels, by far. By far. If you were to take all of the women out of the Gospel of Luke, you would have virtually no Gospel left. And so Luke wants to write to women. That's significant because women were not respected in Jewish culture. And oftentimes today, sadly, women are not respected either. They were not invited to sit and learn at the rabbi's feet. We see here in this passage, Mary is doing something that's very countercultural, sitting at the feet of a rabbi. Could be part of the reason why Martha wants her to get up off her bottom and come into the kitchen and help me, for goodness sake. Women didn't sit at the feet of rabbis. Their place was in the kitchen where Martha is found. Luke is showing that Jesus values women very deeply and wants to restore integrity to women. So that's Luke. Now, what about the passage here? How does it fit into the other stories around it? Right before this passage, in verse 25, there's a lawyer, and he comes up to Jesus, and he says, Jesus, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus says, look in the law. What does the law tell you? What does it say? And he says something very classic. He says, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. That's Deuteronomy chapter 6, the Shema. Jews would constantly be repeating that. And then he says, and love your neighbor as yourself. That's Leviticus 18. And Jesus says, that's exactly right. But then the lawyer says, well, who's my neighbor? And then he gives this the parable of the Good Samaritan. And in the parable of the Good Samaritan, you have a Samaritan, somebody, again, that's marginalized, looked down upon by the Jewish people, and he is elevated above the Pharisee and above the Levite as the one who loved his neighbor. But right after that, the story that we're in, the text we're in today is shared. And here in this story, we see Martha, who is a woman who is showing hospitality, just like the Samaritan. And yet her hospitality is trumped by Mary, who's sitting at the feet of Jesus. What is Mary doing? She's loving the Lord with all her heart, soul, mind, and strength. You have the second and the first commandment right in these two passages. So Mary is an example of loving God. And loving God is greater than the hospitality of Martha. So Luke is elevating Samaritans and women, but more importantly, In this passage, Luke is highlighting the fact that loving God is always greater than serving God. Sitting at the feet of Jesus is the good portion. Ladies, today you have so much pressure put on you. You have to be perfect. To have the perfect well-kept home, you have to have the perfect look, you have to have the perfect family. And Jesus says to you this morning, I just want you to sit at my feet. He's giving you this invitation to rest. Now, maybe you are doing that. Maybe you're reading. Maybe you're praying. But if you are honest, the quality of that has gone south. And you're tired. And Jesus is inviting you to come back to him. This applies to men as well, because the culture around us puts a lot of pressure on us to produce, to be at the top of our game, to be number one. Some of you this morning are doing way too much that is unnecessary. And Jesus is asking you this morning, will you lay some of those expectations, and some of those expectations are expectations that other people are putting on you, will you lay those expectations down and will you just sit at my feet? So here's the big idea of the passage. This is for all of us, men as well. If you focus too much on great things, but you miss the greatest thing, those great things become distractions. Jesus is the greatest thing. He's the most important component of your 24/365. And if you are too preoccupied with great things, good things, Martha's doing amazing things here, but if you're too preoccupied with those things that you forsake the greatest thing, Jesus, your great things become at best distractions, at worst, idols. You know, I thought about another title for this message, but I thought the women might stone me if I said this, an invitation to prioritize. That's like the last thing you want to hear on Mother's Day, right? All right, I'm going to tell you to prioritize things. But what if sitting at the feet of Jesus is the one thing that must be prioritized in order to set all your other priorities in proper order? And so I titled this an invitation to rest. Now let's be honest. Being invited to sit at the feet of Jesus sounds like another thing you got to put onto your schedule, right? It takes time. It takes intentionality. You have to sit. You have to listen. That implies doing nothing but opening your ears and taking in. I mean, who has time to do that? And so when I tell you that Jesus is asking you to sit at the feet of Jesus, you say, oh my gosh, that's just another thing in my day that I need to do. That's the straw that breaks the camel's back. But Jesus' invitation to take his yoke upon you is not an invitation to add more burdens, but rest and to remove burdens. Do you believe that? Have you gotten to a point in your walk where sitting at the feet of Jesus is just like another item in a long laundry list of duties? My first point is, Mary was desperate, but Martha was distracted. We see in this passage that Martha, she is attentive to the needs of others. I mean, who can fault her for that? Look at verse 38. It says that she welcomes Jesus into her house. She's hospitable. Luke just elevated, for goodness sakes, the Samaritan who was hospitable. Hospitality is a great thing. We need that. Verse 40, she's serving. It's the same word that's used in the Bible for deacons. Gosh, we love people who serve. It's interesting, in Luke chapter 10 and John 12, two of the house narratives about Mary and Martha, she's doing the same thing in both places. Martha is a servant. Man. We need servants. Aren't you guys grateful for women who serve and men who serve as well? Aren't we grateful for servants? When you think of people like this, you think of words like selfless, giving, faithful. Here's a list of some very strange and crazy things that moms do. Moms pick up human beings and smell their rear ends. You take your fingers and you stick them into the nose of other human beings. You carry around your shoulder a mini grocery store at all times. You carry loads of laundry, I've seen my wife do this, that are twice your size. And if you ask your husband to carry the same load, he can't do it. You sneak into rooms and quietly check on human beings to see if they're breathing. This is odd. You rock out to music like Wheels on the Bus and Baby Shark, do 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 do, Baby Shark. This is my favorite. You observe, and occasionally you even chart the feces of other human beings. I mean, no one can deny the importance of someone like Martha. What Martha brings as a servant is extremely valuable to the mission of God around her. And yet, in verse 42, Mary is described as having chosen the good portion. Martha is attentive to the needs of others, but Mary is attentive to the words of Jesus. Verse 39, she's sitting and she's listening. Now, here's a little bit of a challenge for myself and for us as men. Are we giving our wives the opportunity to sit and listen? Or are we letting them do everything in the home? I mean, women today, again, it's very different. You have to, most of you work full-time jobs, and you have kids, and you're taking them back and forth, and you're doing things around the house. And so, you know, maybe there's a word for us as men. Are we helping our wives? Am I remembering to do the dishes for my wife after the meal? I always tell myself, make sure you do the dishes, right? We need to give them the space to actually be able to sit at the feet of Jesus. But here in this passage, Mary, she's willing to do the countercultural thing, the thing that the world around her is pressuring her not to do. She's doing. She's sitting at the feet of her rabbi. She's not concerned with what others think. She could care less about what her sister Martha thinks. She is wanting to sit at the feet of the Son of God, the Messiah, Jesus Christ, and nothing is going to take her away from his feet. In both accounts, Martha is serving, in both accounts, Mary is worshiping. The alabaster jar we just sang about, that's Mary. Martha is distracted with much serving, but Mary is desperate for Jesus. I wonder this morning, are you desperate for Jesus? Or do you have enough in your life to where you don't have the sense of desperation? I have to sit at his feet, and I get to sit at his feet. Do you have that kind of desperation? Ladies, I want to remove a little bit of the pressure for you right now. It is okay for your kids to not do every single extracurricular activity. It's really okay. It really is okay for them to not have to do that. It's okay if your home doesn't look like the Facebook page of another person. Mary knows that she's expected to serve with Martha, but she's not going to let those expectations of others take her away from the opportunity before her, which is to sit at the feet of Jesus. Do you see sitting at the feet of Jesus every morning as an opportunity? It's an opportunity for rest. It's an opportunity for your greatest desires to be fulfilled in the living Lord, who has an eternal source of abundance for you. What unrealistic expectations do you have that keep you from sitting at the feet of Jesus? There's no denying that Martha's a servant, and servants are to be valued. Nevertheless, she's distracted from doing the greater thing. And I have a chart put up on the screen behind me. This is a good description of the differences between Martha and Mary. Martha is attentive to the needs of others. Nobody would say anything bad about that. That's a good thing that she's doing that. But Mary is attentive to the words of Jesus. Martha is focused on the details. Praise God for people that are focused on the details. We need that, okay? But she's so focused on the details that she loses sight of the bigger picture. Jesus is there. And she's focused on doing too much in the kitchen. And so Mary is focused on the bigger picture. Martha is a worker. We love workers. Want to be productive, get things done, for goodness sake. But Mary's a worshiper. Martha is distracted. She's anxious. She's troubled. But Mary is at peace. Martha is stuck in the kitchen. Mary is given permission to rest at Jesus' feet. Martha is standing over Jesus. Now, where do I get that? Actually, in the Greek, where it says that she comes to Jesus and begins to talk to him, the implication is she walks up next to him and she's standing over him, kind of like this. Jesus is sitting down. Right? And where's Mary? She's sitting below. She's below Jesus. She's standing. Martha is standing over Jesus, frantic. Mary is looking up, worshiping. She's standing over Jesus. Mary is sitting at the feet of Jesus. Martha craves productivity. And the world craves productivity, doesn't it? And everything in the world around you, your jobs, there's so much that's putting pressure on you to produce. Think about that. And so Martha craves productivity, but Mary, she craves intimacy. You know what's interesting about intimacy with the Lord? Nobody else can see it. Nobody else can see it. Your productivity, everybody sees. And sometimes that's why we want to be so productive, is because we want others to see that we are producing. But intimacy with Jesus, that's an audience of one. Only he sees that. Martha is doing a good thing, and Mary is doing the best thing. Will you consider with me just two passages that speak of good things and better things? Because the New Testament kind of weighs things out like this. There are good things, but then there are better things. First passage is Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. It says this. Jesus says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." Simple math, right? The kingdom of God is greater than all these things. All what things? Food, clothing, good things, important things. We need to be, if a man doesn't work, a man doesn't eat. That's biblical. Very, very good things. But if the kingdom of God is not first, all those other things, unnecessary. Next passage, John chapter 15, verses 5 through 6. Jesus says, "I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing." Abiding in Jesus is greater than doing. In fact, if you don't abide in Jesus, you can do nothing. You can do a lot of things. You can do a lot of things without abiding in Jesus, but nothing that's going to truly be of eternal significance apart from Jesus. And so you are a branch that has to receive the nutrients from that vine. You've got to suck those nutrients out every day. Spend time with Jesus. "Lord, give me strength. Lord, give me power. Lord, enable me to do what I've got to do today. I've got a long list of laundry today. Lord, give me the strength to do it in such a way that you are glorified." You have to abide in Jesus. Otherwise, all the things that you do are nothing. Let's go to the second point. Jesus is to be desired. Jesus is to be desired. What if I told you that every day God is most concerned, not with a list of things, but one thing? Think of all the things that you have to do every day. And what if God were just to take all of that and just go, phew? No, one thing that if nothing else works in your day, your day doing that one thing will be well spent and pleasing and glorifying to him. One thing that will put all the other things into perspective and will allow you to eliminate the unnecessary items on your calendar. One thing that will give you the strength, that you need for the day in front of you, one thing that will enable you to bring God the glory that you long to bring him. Not a laundry list of items, one thing. And what if I told you that the one thing that God wants you to do is the one thing that you truly are craving the most? I love how Jesus addresses Martha. He says, "Martha, Martha." He doesn't come down on her. It's a term of endearment. He says, "You are anxious and you're troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary." Verse 40, Martha says, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me." Who are her eyes on? They're on herself, they're on her sister, but they're not on Jesus. What are you anxious and troubled about? Think about that. What is the thing that keeps you up at night? What is the thing that you're frantic about throughout the day? What distractions are keeping you from the feet of Jesus? Jesus says one thing is necessary. The implication of that one thing is necessary, there are things that are not necessary. How do you read it any other way? Can you feel the frustration in Martha when Jesus says that? One thing is necessary. What I'm doing is unnecessary. I'm working, I'm doing all this stuff. I'm trying to serve, I'm trying to be a good hospitable host. What I'm doing is unnecessary. One thing is necessary, and what I'm doing is not unnecessary. Is that what you're saying? If it's keeping you from the one thing that is necessary, it becomes unnecessary. It does. Here's a good summary of Jesus' words, one thing is necessary in this passage. Listen carefully. When the one thing of greater necessity, sitting at the feet of Jesus, when the one thing of greater necessity is forsaken for things of lesser necessity, showing hospitality, doing things, right? The things of lesser necessity become unnecessary. That's the main point of this message. It's not to say that what Martha is doing isn't important, but what she is doing becomes utterly unimportant in comparison to sitting at the feet of Jesus. If you focus too much on great things but miss the greatest thing, those great things become distractions. It's a great book by a woman named Joanna Weaver. My wife loves this book, A Merry Heart, Having a Merry Heart in a Martha World. How many of you read that book, by the way, or heard of it? Okay, we got a few. Okay. Not surprised. We're to have a merry heart in a Martha world. This world is just like, you need to do this, you need to produce, you need to look this way, you need to have everything together, and you need to get it done now. And you need to produce, for goodness sake. And if you're not, you are not valuable. That's a Martha world. How do you cultivate a merry heart in a Martha world? I want to try to help you with that a little bit. You have to cultivate taste buds. I was trying to think of what image do I want to give here. You have to cultivate taste buds for Jesus. You have to. You have to see the need. You have to see the longing of your soul that maybe you don't recognize right now. You have to develop, you have to cultivate taste buds for Jesus, because the spiritual life is primarily about competing desires. You are a desire factory. God made you that way. And your desires always dictate your choices. Think about that. Sometimes you have to deny certain desires in order for greater desires, but that greater desire is the thing that caused you to deny, right? You came here today because you desired more to be sitting here, praise God for that, rather than sitting at home sleeping. You have a million different choices at any given point in time. The options are endless of what you can do with your life. But your desires always determine, that's a strong word, I'm going to use that word, they always determine your choices. There is no choice that you make that's not the fruit of a deeper desire. So your desires determine your choices. Your choices determine your destiny. That means your desires are of utter importance to God and of utter importance to your salvation. God is this way as well. Think about it. There's nothing that God does that doesn't flow from his nature, his desires, and he makes choices. And this is why there's certain things that God cannot do. God cannot lie, right? God cannot stop being just. Everything that God does flows from deeper desires within him. Sometimes his desire is for his glory to be displayed more than other things, but those things are still important to God, but there's a greater desire that he has that trumps that. And so he makes decisions, and this is how he ordains and decrees everything in the world. And this is why he does it perfectly, because God's desires are perfect. You and me, not so much. We have competing desires. And so we need to allow the word of God to tell us what kind of desires should I have and how do I cultivate those desires, because your desires will dictate your choices and your choices will determine your destiny. Jesus is more satisfying than anything else, and he longs to satisfy your desires in him because that is what will bring him the most glory. That's why we were created, to glorify God. How do we glorify God? We glorify God by enjoying God. By saying, you're worthy, you're good, by tasting and seeing that the Lord is good. You're worth my time, Lord. You're worth everything. I lay everything down at your feet if only I could gain you. You know who's honored when we do that? God is honored when we do that. God is glorified. And so the deepest desires that you have and your greatest mission to glorify God are not opposed to one another. They find their completion in one another because you desire God and God desires you and created you to desire God. You see that? This is good news, guys. This is good news that your greatest desires are fulfilled in Jesus, and Jesus' greatest command for you is to fulfill your desires in him. That's great news. It's an invitation to rest. It's an invitation to sit at the feet of the source of all that is satisfying, Jesus. But all your life, you've been taught something different. And you're still being taught it right now out in the world. Food is greater. Approval is greater. Ambition, physical beauty, a clean home, a bigger house, respect of others, productivity, fill in the blank. Your flesh is tailored to believe that these things that you are pursuing are truly what you're desiring, and they're not. They're not. You were not created that way. It will never satisfy you. They will not hold up. Not even good things, not even great things. You were created to enjoy and to find your fulfillment, your satisfaction in God. All right, in closing, I want to give you some practical steps, because I know some of you are here are like, okay, Brian, I hear what you're saying. I hear you're saying that my desire is truly fulfilled and found in God, but I'm not there right now. And to be quite honest, if I were to be honest, sitting at the feet of Jesus feels like another thing I need to do. And to be quite honest, my time in the Word is very dry right now. And I'm not receiving these words like satisfying and fulfilling. I don't feel that way when I spend time with Jesus. Will you help me? Okay. Here are some practical steps. First, approach expectantly. Approach expectantly. James chapter 4, verse 8. What a glorious verse. It says this. It says, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. That God would draw near to you when you just make a step towards him. That's all you gotta do. And he will make two steps towards you. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. What a glorious promise. That as far from God as I might feel, I may be outside of the house, I may be banging on the door, all I gotta do is make a step. And God runs like the prodigal son was ran to by his father. He runs to you. He runs to you. Because he wants you to spend time with him far more than you desire to spend time with him. Believe that. So approach expectantly. Expect that he will come towards you. And here's some little practical things. Small meals create a greater appetite. You know? Don't burden yourself with, oh, I gotta read 10 chapters or whatever. You know, don't put these massive expectations on yourself. Start small. Start where you feel the most fulfilled. If you like going outside, go for a walk. Go for a walk with Jesus. Listen to his word, you know, and then just pause and pray. And 15 minutes, just start there. And then pray and say, God, my heart's not in the right place here. I want to desire you like I know I'm supposed to. Will you help me? Done. You know what? That might not feel, and I know we've had these times, right? Where we spend time with Jesus and it doesn't feel fulfilling and it doesn't feel like I'm there, right? We've had those times and we feel this existential sense of guilt, right? But know this, when you approach Jesus just simply to do that, to do the thing, that honors God. How? Because it's a step of faith, and faith always honors God. You don't have to be in a perfect place to start. Just approach and approach expectantly. Number two, cast your distractions on the altar. Now, this is hard. What is the altar? The altar is a place of a burnt offering. It costs you something. There are things in your life right now, all of us, that are distracting you from quality time with Jesus. And they're good things. Maybe not. Maybe they're bad things. Maybe those things need to be cast off anyways. But a lot of times, oftentimes, they're good things. And you got to sacrifice that to him. You got to put that on the altar. 1 Peter 5:7 says, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. What is that thing this morning? What is that thing that you need to sacrifice to God on the altar? Third, trust the process. Trust the process. You know, you may not receive, again, the fulfillment that you desire right away. It may feel dry. It may feel distant. It may feel like your prayer doesn't even reach past the ceiling. But by faith, know that it does, because Jesus has made the way for you. You may not feel like God loves you, but know that he does, because the Bible says, listen to this, Jesus praying to the Father in John 17, and he says, you love them as you love me. Whew. The Father loves you. Think about the intensity that the Father loves the Son of God, Jesus. And Jesus says, you love them as you love me. Wow. So there's things that you have to be in the Word, and you have to just train yourself to think biblically about these things, right? Trust the process. You have competing desires that will keep you from this. Food, sleep, movies, because that's where you're finding your satisfaction right now. That's what gives you rest. Good. Again, good things. Nobody would say you can't watch a movie. I would never tell you that. But is it distracting you from time with Jesus? You have to cultivate your desires to be satisfied in Christ alone. I want to close with one verse, and it's probably my favorite verse in the Bible, and it's actually a parable. Before I read it, I want to kind of give you this story. So there's a man, and he's walking through this field, and it's not his field. In Jesus' day, you could do that. You could walk through other people's field, and they wouldn't pull out a shotgun and shoot you. So he's walking through this guy's field, and he kind of does this. And he looks down, and he realizes, oh my gosh, there's something that's buried here. So he gets a shovel, you know, and he starts digging in this guy's backyard. I'm not sure why the shotgun didn't come out at this point, but it didn't. He's digging this hole, and he realizes, oh my gosh, there's a chest. And he opens this chest, and he opens it up, and there's, let's just say for sake of comparison, there's $2 million worth of jewels and stuff in this chest. And he realizes the owner of the field does not know that this is here. So he looks around, and he quickly closes it up, puts it back in the ground and he buries it. And he goes, oh my gosh, I can't steal this. That would be wrong. But if I buy this field from this man, I'll get the treasure as well. So he looks on Zillow and he realizes that the house is worth $1 million. But if he buys the house, he gets $2 million with his treasure, right? $1 million. He goes home and he looks at his home and he says, okay, I think I could sell this. I think I could sell this for about $500,000. That doesn't quite get me to where I need to be. But I got the jewelry here. I've got all this stuff in my house. Man, but this stuff's really important to me. I've worked all my life for all this. This is very important. But he realizes as he looks around, he says, you know what? If I sold all this stuff, I'd have $1 million and I could go and I could buy that field and I could have that treasure. Now let's read the verse. It says, Matthew 13:44, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. And in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. The treasure is greater than all that he has. In his joy, he says, I don't need any of this stuff. I'm going to buy this field. I'm going to have $2 million. I can buy better stuff. In his joy, he gives up everything he has because of the one thing, the treasure. Jesus says, the kingdom of heaven is like that. The kingdom of heaven is like that. It's like a treasure. God is not asking you to lay your desires down at the altar. He's asking you to find your desire in him. And he's asking you to lay down other things that are getting in the way. What are those things that are getting in the way from you finding your ultimate satisfaction in God? This man was willing to give up great things, everything he owned, in order to gain the greatest thing, the treasure. Are you willing to take God at his word this morning by faith and say, God, I know you are a greater treasure to be enjoyed. I know that you are glorified when I am satisfied in you. I'm willing this morning to lay down, fill in the blank, my distractions, good things that are getting in the way of the best thing, Jesus. Let's pray. God, in this time, I'm asking, Lord, would you show each person here what is that thing or those things that need to be given up. Things that are good, they're necessary, they're important, but they're distractions because they're getting in the way of you. God, I'm asking for you to send your spirit here and just give the people here that very thing. And Lord, may you give them the grace and the faith to surrender that over to you. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you that we can celebrate the wonderful women in our church and in our families. May they be honored. May they be glorified. And may they receive, God, this morning a greater invitation from you to rest in them. In Jesus' name.